Thank you very much. There's something about speaking in the church, isn't it? Talking about the differences between art and religion. Would the interpretation of Aernout's work by Ralph create some questions?
I would like to ask that you mentioned that the goal of Aernout Mik's work would be that it should reconnect us in some kind of sense. And I think I opposed to that because if you look at his videos, they take a long time. It is not that moralistic, and I don't think it's that optimistic that it should be able. So I wonder, can you explain yourself?
And I must say, I think it's possible to have many different reactions to these videos, but I know as I've seen more and more of them at different times and different places, I do have different reactions to them. But I think what I mean is not that we're reconnected to each other in some kind of utopian way, but that we're making an effort to connect to these images rather than just to consume them, that we're making an effort to make sense of them. One of Aernout's key installation strategies is usually to project video so that it has some of the qualities of a sculptural installation. And he uses a rear screen projector so that you can walk right up to the image and you're not going to cast a shadow on it. The images are often on shaped walls. They often curve around you so that you're immersed in this visual field. They go down to the floor. Now it's interesting to me that raw footage breaks from this pattern, and it's actually the first installation of Aernout's that I know of, where he's actually got the projectors in front of the screens, like most people show videos. And there's not a sense, I mean, in this other approach, he also does not show videos in a dark room. Okay, in a pitch black room, he shows videos in a room that has dim lighting, so that you can still see your own body in that room and relate it to the scale of the bodies on the screen. And the videos are often projected at a size so that those bodies on the screen are life size. All of these things address your situation in looking at this work. Now, for some of us, that may seem alienating because it's a lot easier to sit in a dark room and escape into something that's not addressing us, but it's offering us a way out. But I think to have that connection that I'm talking about, you need to have a confrontation. You need to be addressed by something. And I think Aernout is very carefully thinking out how his work can address you and make you feel that it's taking your presence into account through these different strategies. I mean, I found that there's a lot of contemporary art that seems to be completely oblivious to the viewer's presence. It doesn't care if you exist or not. When the artist hasn't thought of a way to take your looking, your presence, your attitude into account. But this, I think, is very different. So I think even though there is a sense of things, disintegration, a sense of social entropy, cultural entropy, I think there's this moment, this opening, and show you a way that gives me a little sense of optimism. But it's not utopian. You know, I think again we need to have this idea of a spectrum where, you know, we don't just immediately press the utopian button when we're talking about optimism, but we have a measure of optimism.
I have a question with regard to the fact that you said rightly so, I think, that there are no sort of psychological individuals or in the work of Aernout Mik, but I had the impression, especially with this project, that this for the first time that there was another type of narrative pattern that was developed into which certain types of characters were foregrounded, that suddenly people became identifiable individuals within that notion of the crowd or the mass. And I found that very peculiar, and I don't really know if that's a sort of personal interpretation or if it's something that you also observed?
Let me ask, did you find that more in raw footage or in scapegoats?
And I mean with scapegoats.
Yeah. Scapegoats, okay. You know, I think for me it's not that different from art in its earlier work, but in that even in a lot of the earlier works, there are characters in the camera comes back to them over again, and you see them going through states of transformation. So in a sense, there is some kind of art to their development. And you can obviously identify things about them by their dress, how they, you know, how they hold themselves, etc. But there's never an exploration of what we might think of as psychological relationships and issues, because their behavior doesn't seem to be motivated by psychological issues. It seems that they're acting out specific activities, but almost in a way that's kind of mindless. That's part of, again, a group think behavior.
I noticed that one very specific scene in raw footage is also part of Dire History, Johan Grimond plays film. I don't know if you know which scene I mean.
Which one is it?
Yeah, it's very specific because it's a man with a camera who's filming and he's standing against a 19th century building and then he gets shot. He has to drop his camera and has to flee. But you don't know if there's any specific, yeah, probably. No, Arnold is not here, so I cannot ask him, but it's...
And your question is?
Yeah, it cannot be coincidence, I mean, that's for sure.
Daniela assisted Arnold in researching images. I wonder whether you can refer to the concrete one.
Said that I don't think he knew that image. And there is a whole section which is at the end of the raw footage, which is about media, where he showed the role of the media, where you have images in Slovenia of the media constantly sort of attacking the soldiers with questions and the soldiers say, please go away, you know, there's tanks here. And he made this whole compilation of which is where you see the role of the media. So I don't think it was specifically.
So it's coincidence.
I think it's a coincidence.
Okay.
Yeah. I also wanted to say one thing in relation to what you said about Aernout using sound and also using screens instead of sculptural constructions in space. That I do think there is a sense of sculpture in a way that he's using the sound, because he specifically wanted to have the sound coming from the screens, and he installed them in a way that he wanted to create zones of intensity by using the sound. So in a way he is again using the space in a I believe a sculptural way, but maybe a sound sculptural way, but not in a physical.
Yeah, it's interesting because I think the fact that all his other videos are silent is one of the qualities that gives them a seamlessness, a sense of seamlessness, along with a camera that's kind of moving and a kind of soothing, very smooth, controlled movement. And sound provides moments of disruption, moments of rupture, disjunction. Which is missing from those earlier videos. That occurs on a purely visual level. And so it becomes intensified because there is no sound. And in trying to think about the sound in raw footage, which does, you know, there's nothing like that sound of a gun at a distance, which is not the same as the kind of Hollywood gun sound that we're used to seeing. It's a very casual gun sound. I mean, it seems, in a way, it's a sound that undoes our stereotype of what the sound would be like of a bomb hitting a building. So I think it's able to serve a purpose there that I don't think it could in his own videos. Just only because we know that it's real sound. And I think maybe that's the side we're looking at any one moment. And in a way, it takes this particular conflict out of any kind of arena where we can make a moral judgment, where we can say, oh, the Serbs were terrible people, the Croats were barbarians. It's all so mixed up. And that, does that make this a kind of depoliticized work? And that it starts to suggest a universal picture of the kinds of confusions that are generated by war and what's left out. In other words, looking at what's left out of our media, which then shows us how constructive our images of war are. If that's one intention, is the other intention that we end up with this depoliticized representation where we're incapable of being able to make a moral judgment? Or is it not the duty of a work of art to put us in a position of making a moral judgment? So that we should not expect that kind of political attitude from works of art.
Is there somebody who feels addressed?
Maybe that question is too complicated.
Not at all, Stephen.
When you have footage that isn't claimed by a news corporation, there's a certain implication that footage is somewhat inert, in a way. And I'm wondering if, inherently, the fact that this is unused footage is not going to give you that intensity. That the images that have that intensity are the ones that are culled by the media to use for political purposes. So in a way, we have a cast-off, which by its very nature is non-specific. So I think that would be an important issue of what footage, of why it gets left there. Maybe it gets left there for these reasons.
Aernout is not only show footage that has never been shown. It can also be footage that has been shown, but he's showing it in a different compilation, or he's showing it in a different time frame. So it's not, for example, footage where you have an action of a soldier. He will use it because there's a form of normality coming into the action. So there's a different sense of the action, or you look at the reality in a different way. But it's not, he didn't particularly search for only footage that has never been shown.
You wanted to move on.
Well, I mean, the other question, I'm still interested in this area, just because we're at a moment like that where there's a lot of politically engaged work, and maybe this reached a very public moment in the last documenta curated by Oakley and Isola, where there was a lot of work that is truly partisan, that says, you know, this is a good cause, I support it. The other guys are doing terrible things. And it's not questioning how we represent those things, those types of issues. And I think I know a lot of young artists are very interested in activism. There was recently a curator in the United States, Chris Gilbert, who was at the Berkeley Art Museum, who was dismissed from the museum at Berkeley, is a famously liberal place in the United States. He was dismissed when he insisted that the museum, which was showing an exhibit of work from Venezuela about factories that are controlled by the workers, that they put a wall text saying that they supported the revolutionary struggle of the workers of Venezuela. And the museum said, that's not our job to take a side like that, so we quit. So we're living in a moment where a certain kind of unquestioning political activism it's coming back into the art world. We're also in a moment when all kinds of social groups and NGOs are very interested in using art to promote their causes. In England, this is most evident probably in terms of the environmental movement, that they are really trying to enlist artists to make artwork about global warming. And for most artists, this means you're going to be making a kind of propaganda for a cause that you support. But we're also in a moment in our history as a planet where maybe the next 10 or 15 years are going to really be a turning point in terms of what happens in the future in terms of global warming. Does that mean that we all should be rethinking what role art should play in society? Or do we assume that?
I think the best art will always not force you to take a stand for think in a certain direction or force a certain message or force you to take a moral step. You'll always write about that or be more ambiguous. And in that, be more effective.
To do with taking sides, what do you think the relationship between the two videos or the one video that is shown on two screens has to do with taking sides and the engagement and a moral taking side, because you have to decide on which one you're looking at.
Well, there, I think that decision to, show the work on multiple screens, which is something Aernout has done over and over again, does involve that kind of decision-making process. And it does make you feel that you can't see the whole video, you can't see everything. All the facts are not available to you. Your point of view is always going to be partial. You only will see a fragment of the whole picture. And it's a reminder again and again that okay, we have imperfect knowledge. Our point of view then is something that we have to treat somewhat provisionally. At the same time, I think maybe there also come moments when you have to say that however provisional your information is, that's all you have right now, and you have to make a decision based on that information. I think throughout the 20th century, to me, one of the main strategies of a lot of interest in art was to position itself on a threshold between art and non-art, between art and something that couldn't be recognized really as art initially, until that convention became accepted. And that became a way of, in a sense, creating a space around art that would force people to look at it with a kind of open mind. It's the only kind of mind with which you can really have a full experience of art, I think, but you're not quite sure what it is. I mean, there's something about uncertainty that makes us curious, and it lets us entertain possibilities that we don't entertain when we're dead certain about something. So there's something about uncertainty as opposed to being dead certain. It's really about aliveness of mind. I don't know quite how I got on that track. Except that, that is this whole history of art that I think some people come out and have said it very clearly. I think now we're at a place where art, in 20 years or so, has been less concerned with that kind of position and much more concerned with looking at cultural conventions across a wide range of kind of cultural and social fields. And again, as Aernout does, we're often mingling those conventions in ways that again leave us unsure what we're looking at, which again gives us a chance to look at those conventions anew, to reassess them in a different way. Which comes down to this cliche of art is something that helps us look at the world differently. guess I have a question. Is that strategy something that has now become so conventional in itself that we're at a point where we're looking for something else to go beyond that?
Yes, I would like to react on some earlier things you said. I do think it's very important that artists at this time try to depoliticize certain positions, because we're now getting in a sort of period in time where you can say that we have to sort of reconstruct a new international society. And I think by using art as a tool to give us a new way to look at things, it makes it also possible to construct new ways of social organization in our mind. Eventually, society is mind made matter, it's mental construction. And with that, I do believe that the alignment with art and NGOs can be actually maybe even a little bit dangerous, because it only will reassert the old political model instead of creating a new, or showing the possibilities for a new political model. So I do think that artists should try to give people a chance to make a moral judgment about certain conflict situations, as Aernout does. I think it's a very good work.
Thanks, Matt. I agree.
Anyone else?
There's a question to my phone.
Hi, I guess I have a comment and a kind of a criticism, perhaps. Speaking of making judgments, moral judgments, or trying to understand the people in the images without being isolated from them, I guess I would like to just, not quote, but some kind of just rephrase Emmanuel Levinas, for whom, in case you are supposed to recognize the other, in case you are supposed to see the other, encounter them in the face and empathize with them, we're supposed to put truth after the other in general. The person comes before the truth. You had this comment about some images with soldiers talking on cell phones under Coca-Cola umbrellas, or women having a chit-chat and a cappuccino while there's something terrible going on in the background. And saying that this is a consumeristic, detached way of being, I think it's a judgment, because if you empathize with them, they're not at that moment really thinking about a sociological fact, a statistics that has been parsed through reason and scientifically studied that this is a consumerist way of living. It's just a moment in which they would remind themselves that life could be normal. There's hope in that. They are, with their way of pretending like life is normal, weighing an eyeshadow while I'm taking my gun to go to war, I'm trying to keep a hope. They show that these people still have hope. I mean, this is just another kind of judgment that I'm putting. There could be many different ways of interpreting, which I found quite a little bit problematic, perhaps, in your interpretation, because there were just, for me, there were too many judgments already. Thank you.
Thanks. I mean, I didn't sound, to me, it wasn't so much a judgment on those individuals. It's more just about, I think, how that consumerist relationship to the world is embedded so thoroughly in every aspect of our lives that we can now have a kind of war that still follows, that still allows a place for that. I mean, to me, perhaps the first big kind of example of this was the Vietnam War, where you had American troops playing rock music while they went into battle. And, you know, I think this is not something that's completely new. I mean, we know, say, in World War II, the Red Cross, which is supposed to be a charity organization, was, you know, going around the battle front, charging 10 cents for a cup of coffee and basically running a, you know, Starbucks in the middle of the war, that there was commercial enterprise there. But it's, to me, the attitude I'm thinking about is more a kind of, in the US there's this expression that's very popular with people of a certain age, whatever. You know, it's like, oh, well, whatever. And to me, that's the perfect expression of this kind of consumerist attitude. And I might disagree with what you're doing, but I don't care enough to get involved. I want to go on living my life as if everything was normal. And whatever you were doing had nothing to do with what I'm doing. So there is a kind of disconnection. And that's what I was talking about. It wasn't a judgment on this people.
Aaron, you were talking about consumerism before. You said you might come back to that. And so I was wondering about the images that you were just talking about. It's hard to phrase the question, I think. But in relation to what you were just saying, could you just expand on how we as spectators become consumers? I think this is what you were referring to.
Well, I mean, I think, yeah, if I go to watch a kind of escapist Hollywood movie, which I like to do from time to time, it's a very detached experience, right? I'm sitting in a dark theater, I have no connection with anyone else really in that physical space. We're a crowd of strangers, it remains a crowd of strangers. My relationship to what's on the screen is very much, in a sense, just having something downloaded directly to my brain without any questions, without any real involvement for me, except making minimal effort to follow a storyline, which is usually spelled out in such obvious terms that it doesn't take much of an effort. So it's like eating candy. You don't really think much about what it tastes like because it's so sweet. And I think, obviously, Aernout's work asks us to be a more active kind of consumer.
I was wondering how the moral issues on the war representation were being dealt with, especially in the case of the staged part of the work. Seeing the fact that in the raw footage part, all the unspectacular elements of war are being presented, what about the fact of making a spectacle of war and letting, in some way, letting it fascinate us or letting us, our eyes feast on it without ever taking part or asking ourselves questions whether who we are looking at and why should we be looking in? Is that a spectacle to be made of? Is that addressable or are we supposed to ignore these issues?
Yeah, that's a very good question. I mean, for me, this, I didn't really see the main spectacular imagery in these videos. So I don't think there are, you know, there's no sublime images of the horrors of the war. And they do let us think very much about how war, when it's being fought in this kind of a war, takes on this veneer of normalcy and bleeds into everyday life. And that there are so many kinds of violence, I think, and so many social tensions in everyday urban life anyway. But it's not a matter of black and white, of a clear line. It's just a matter of a spectrum, of going a little step further to having a civil war, from having the kind of violence that you have in some cities, like at least in London. It's a very violent city, actually. But it's now kind of a Dickensian place, where there are street gangs, and the difference between rich and poor is so extreme. That it creates a very volatile social atmosphere where there is no cohesion. You know, I guess to me the trade-off in Aernout's work is just in order to look at things at the level of representation, he abstracts from the specifics of this particular conflict and removes us from any kind of historical understanding of what led to this conflict, how it developed. You know, I mean, there are many, many contextual factors. But again, we're not seeing on the television news. But that is a project that artists are saying, I'm not interested in this historical project. I'm interested in this broader, almost metaphysical issue. How do we go about representing? How do we go about representing things in a way that makes sure that we see the artifice in that representation? That we see the limits of that mode of representation. And that we know that behind that particular image, there are many, many other things that are going on. And it's not a fixed representation. So, if you have a strategy to do that, can you still engage with the historical? You know, that's a question that I think is still up in the air for me.
There's still another question.
I think the historical aspect, I guess most of us know of that conflict, and I think the really amazing thing in this work is that work is that it really shows the normalcy and the banality of the war and the banality of evil also of the war, and that it makes it can get up, have breakfast, do your eyes and makeup and go to war. It's so intense and so immediate also for these people that there's no escape also. It makes them, I think, in a way less human. That they do these things, so these cruel things, and see that, seem to believe that it's normal just to do it. But it also makes them more human, because it is so. It's just their world and their life at that time. And I think this is maybe also the moral issue of that work to show that it's not the special and heroic thing you see in the movies. That's so fucking damn real.
Well, no, I would agree with that. And I would say the other thing I think it does for me is it makes me think that, again, as I said just a moment ago, there's not a huge difference maybe between what we're watching in some of these scenes and what urban life is like in some areas. I mean, I know there are parts of London where people have to run across the street because they're afraid of what might happen to them if they did it. Or people can't take a certain bus at night because if they get on the bus, something could happen to them. So these scenes of people running in fear in a city, you know, in a way, I think it's something that we see going on anyway. So there's a connection here. And it seems close to home in more ways than one.
I wondered whether there's one more. There are two questions. Maybe I'm going to ask the third question and we'll bring it to the more abstract level to conclude. Because you made me think when you asked, did he actually depoliticize war in Yugoslavia? And that made me think, again, the history. The reality of war is kind of known to everybody, but kind of all know somehow, from here at least, who were the aggressors, etc., the whole story. But I do not think this has to do with the political, as we usually think or speak of it in art. I wonder what your idea of the political in art would then be.
Well, I mean, I think it's what I call the politics, how we think, how we perceive, how we categorize things. And, you know, I started out by saying that war makes crowds, and I think it creates camps and an opposition. And I think what Aernout's work is trying to get us to do is to look at those big blocks with which we categorize society in one way or another, and to break them down so that we can't make those clear distinctions anymore. And you know, I think it's a very interesting question in terms of how you then try to relate that, which is an ideal way of thinking, to a political life where you're taking practical positions and having to make finite decisions and choices. I mean, I don't think there's a simple answer.
But thank you for this one. Yeah.
Thanks very much.
And for a wonderful lecture and that conversation. Thank you very much, everybody, for coming. And maybe you'd agree that it's a moment we could provide an impulse to reform this crowd. Because you heard already some sounds from the back. There are some drinks we'd like to offer, and maybe an occasion for more intimate and more informal talks amongst ourselves. Thank you again.